together. When it all goes wrong, the fires, they keep burning on. Well, I'll hold myself together.
Welcome to Freezer Social.
Today on the podcast, we have a special guest, an ex-football player.
Come on.
Played for teams like Crystal Palace, Stoke City.
Jeez.
We're going to be touching on topics like culture within the game, racism in the game, black managers. Keep your eyes peeled.
Stay tuned. Come on.
Welcome back to Freezer Social.
Was a party.
Come on, today we've got a big guest.
Massive.
A former footballer. Played for teams such as Hull City, Stoke City, Charlton.
Oof, man. Athletic. Big names.
Athletic. Charlton Athletic. Millwall. Southend United. Burnley. Name drop. Come on.
Come on, name drop.
Man like the defender.
The enforcer.
Leon Court is in the building. It's mad. I can't believe it.
And it's
Leon
Fugazi.
It's real.
For real, you know. Leon Court.
Thank you for coming down, Leon.
Thanks for coming.
Pleasure to be here, boys.
It's mad, you know. Bro, I used to watch MOTD in this living room. Leon Court playing alongside Ryan Shawcross. And this was when Ryan Shawcross was coming big.
Yeah, you know what I mean?
Court was just heading. Banging in goals, you know what I'm saying? It's mad. Thanks for coming on. It's a big moment for us, you know what I mean? When you reach out to us, we're just like, rah, this is mad.
Surreal.
Yeah, man. Honestly. So, how you been, man? How you been? How's it going?
I've been good. I've been enjoying retirement. Retired in 2014.
Yeah.
You know, so ever since then, I've just been keeping busy. It was a bit difficult when I left the game straight away because it's... the bubble bursts and you're into the real world.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? Which is that's the thing that people don't really see. Footballers are in a bubble a bit. And then when they finish, you kind of think, oh, wow, like there's no more stadiums.
Yeah, that's awesome. So how was that transition?
For me, if I'm honest, I was never overly in love with the game anyway.
Yeah.
Do you know what it was? Because I knew I had a talent.
Yeah.
I'll take that back. I was in love with the game. Like playing with my friends. Especially when I was at Southend, young, 21, enjoying the game. And as you get into it more, it starts to become a normal job. And it takes it away a bit.
Like you make a mistake
and you get lambasted by everyone. Press everyone. It's a lot of pressure, to be honest. Yeah, you know, there's parts of it you enjoy loads and there's parts of it you don't. You know, but that's what I've been. That's how I found it when I retired.
Yeah. So, you know what? Tell us about your journey. How did you come to find football? When did you discover that? Okay, this is, you know, what I want to be doing.
For a profession, for a career. As long as I know.
When I was a kid.
Yeah, I know. You probably hear that a lot from people.
Yeah.
You know, but it was. We used to go out and play in the snow. It didn't matter. We just wanted to play football. When I started to realise, you know, I've actually got something, it's when I was at Dulwich Hamlet.
I was pretty young,
I was like 40.
Is that where you're from, sorry?
I'm from Elephant Castle.
Elephant Castle?
Yeah. Dulwich is like 20.
Yeah.
I was in goal when I was young, when I was nine, and Wimbledon wanted to sign me.
As a goalkeeper.
Wow. They wanted to sign me in goal, but I found it so boring. I was standing there for a lot.
You don't do much.
So I just thought, you know, I'm gonna try on pitch. And everyone laughed and stuff, but went to defender, and you know the rest is history. But that's how I started.
That's actually crazy, you know. Wimbledon wanted to sign you at nine.
So when did you join Millwall?
Because that was your
Millwall was when I was at Dulwich.
Okay.
Because when I was at Dulwich, I was playing pretty well, and clubs were coming to see me and stuff. And then I was training one day, and then I was just running. And hit someone on even ground, and my ankle was facing the other way.
I was done.
I was so much pain. It was broken to pieces. So
yeah.
Went to Dulwich Hospital, and they said that you're never going to play again. So then I thought, no way, I'm going to get myself back.
Yeah.
So I carried on playing, but I had a bit of a limp, you know, when I came back, because I never had any pr- proper surgery or anything.
Mm. Yeah.
But I carried on playing and strapped it up. But after games, I would just go crashing down all the time.
Yeah.
Because I wanted to play. I wasn't a young kid. I wasn't done.
For real.
So then I got back to a decent level, got back to Dulwich, and then the manager said Millwall are interested in you. So I thought, okay, I'll go down for a trial.
How old were you at this point?
I was 18. So wow. I gave up.
So it was later.
I missed all the youth team, YTS, all that stuff, all the coaching that you need.
Yeah.
I was raw. Like, you know, I was strong, I was powerful, could hit it, kick it, whatever.
Yeah.
But up here, I wasn't nowhere near the guys that were already at Millwall.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So I went down for a trial, done really well. They wanted to sign me and everything. And then I had one more game to go through, one more game, and then what happened? I think playing against West Ham, and I knew I was getting signed anyway, and I jumped up, and this damn ankle went again.
Jeez.
But I carried on playing in the game.
Yeah,
it was my Achilles was hanging on by a string.
Jeez.
And I knew that if I came off, they weren't going to sign me, and my career was done. So I knew that I had to get through this game.
Were you hobbling? Were you limping?
I was in pieces. I was hobbling all over the place, like. But
and the manager didn't notice.
I tried. Yeah, it was the last 20 minutes, so I had to just get through the game.
You must have thought, raw soldier, we need this brother.
When I look back, I don't know how I done it.
I don't know how.
But do you
think that was that a bit risky though, trying to
carry on?
Yeah.
But I knew that if I walked off, I said to manager, I can't. I knew that they would have.
So it's kind of like the same fate. If I stay on and it gets worse, then I'm going to get signed.
Sounds similar to Yellow.
If I come off, I'm going to get signed. Sort of thing. So
basically,
well.
I had to stay on.
Yeah.
I had to stay on. I got through it and they signed me on a 2-year deal.
Oh,
and then as soon as the ink wasn't even dry before I
signed it. Agent!
I'm done. That's what happened after that.
How did you feel though when they said, obviously you said you knew, but when you were actually sitting down, signing. How did you feel?
It felt good. It's something that I never thought would happen because 18 is very late to make it pro football. But Millwall wasn't a great time for me after that because there was a lot of envy and jealousy from a lot of the lads because they'd been there for 2-3 years before me learning their trade.
Yeah.
Some of them knew they were getting released and I came in and got a 2-year deal.
Okay.
And obviously, my brother was at Newcastle. He got at that time. He just got bought for $7 million.
So your brother Carl Court.
Yeah.
Name drop. Come on.
He went to Newcastle. He went to Newcastle, and then they were like, "Oh, you're only here because of your brother." So I was getting it from a lot of the boys. But I'll be honest with you, I wanted to knock them out.
Yeah,
I did, because I was from a place. You got to remember, those guys are from a different place.
Mm.
They were running their mouth so much to me. Like, but I knew that you couldn't do that to me on the street.
Yeah.
The way you were talking to me. But I knew that I couldn't do anything to them because if I do anything to them, I'm gone.
Yeah, that's it.
You know? And these little weedy boys saying ridiculous things to me. Because I've always been a quiet guy.
Yeah.
Respectful guy. Just treat me with respect, I'll treat you with respect. Yeah. I've always been like that.
Yeah.
But those guys, they pushed it to the limit
a
bit with me there. You know? And so I had to find my own strength inside to get through it. And
it is tough though because it's hard to separate us as, you know, men, where we're from, because we're coming from, you know, tough upbringings from the profession. You know, you always have to conduct yourself differently, and it's tough, man. I mean, kudos to you, because it's not easy.
It's very in the workplace, you think the same thing. Like, if you have someone speaking to you a certain way or shouting at you, you're thinking, hold on, what?
What are you doing? The thing is, I'm not a violent guy at all. I'm not violent at all. You know, but when they know that you're not doing anything, that's when they push it. When I look back, I should have made a statement to someone. I'm not saying punched him. I'm not saying do that. But if you make a statement, they won't do it again.
Yeah.
And I didn't make that statement. Because I was, like I say, I was raw. I was from a place where I just wanted to make it. And I didn't know they would be so ruthless there.
Yeah.
You know, they try and do things to, like, embarrass you. Like, on a Friday, they would put the first team sheet up. And the 20 man squad will be up, right? And there's all the first team guys, the big men and stuff. And what they'd do, they would write my name, like one of the youth team boys would pretend that I'm in the squad and write my name. So I'd come in thinking, oh great, I'm in the squad, traveling with the first team.
Yeah.
Get my tracksuit on, go with the first team, and I'd get on the coach, and manager goes like, what are you doing here? I'm like, oh, I'm in the squad. No, you're not.
Right.
And I have to get off the coach embarrassed.
Yeah.
Pagan.
Because some boy that's already got released is upset.
Yeah,
you
right. You know,
and signed. Yeah, and stuff like that. That's what they would do, but I guess it's part of the game.
Yeah.
So wow. did you went through the academy process? Yeah, the whole.
No, I missed it.
So you missed it.
I caught the last 6 months of it, and all those guys have been there for 2-3 years.
Yeah. Okay, so what I mean, I'm sure you watch Yado's podcast. What things, what provisions are in place for players that are going through that? Like, could you speak to anyone at the club about the way you were treated there?
The club?
Yeah.
No. It's you can't show any weakness.
That's it. Show weakness and you get taken.
This is football. Yeah. You're not allowed to show any weakness. That and it's a shame. Because there's so many players hiding stuff. So many players hiding things.
Yeah.
But they can't show anything. They can't show any weakness. Mm. And this is the problem where, as you probably go into later, where the mental health stuff comes into it.
Mm.
Because a lot of players are hiding a lot of pain.
Yeah.
Mm. You know, they've got talent, they're good boys, but there's more to it.
Okay. So how did obviously all of that, you're going through a lot of stuff, these people, you know, targeting you. How did that translate to performances on the pitch where you're kind of shutting people up like, I'm here, I'm playing well.
Yeah, I was playing well. I know I was playing well. Mm. And as soon as you make one mistake, they're on you.
Mm.
One mistake. Yeah. Loads of players would give the ball away. Come on, so-and-so, you can do better than that. Encourage.
Mm.
When it was me, manager as well. He didn't, because he didn't want to sign me.
Swear.
No, the youth team manager didn't want to sign me. But the top guy, the first team manager, Billy Bonds at the time, said, no, I want him.
Yeah.
I want him. And that got the youth team manager angry. So every time I used to train and stuff, he used to just be on me.
Looking for an excuse just to...
Yeah, just to have a go.
Did you feel that the UT manager like kind of showed that kind of, you know, aggression towards any other players in the team? Just you?
No, he was hard. He was hard, but it was a different sort of hard.
Mm.
That also translates to the other players as well, because if they can see it, they're thinking, yeah, man, I don't really want
to. Yeah, so that's when they felt confident enough to like say,
if he's talking to him like that, then we can...
Basically, yeah. As well. Yeah.
So favoritism does exist.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, the guys that were there, they weren't better than me.
Mm.
But for me, that's my opinion. Football's all about opinions,
right?
I felt they weren't better than me, but they've been there for 2-3 years, so they learnt a bit more.
Mm.
You know, the positional sense, things like that, important things in the game.
They remember you were also injured for a bit, innit? Mm. And you just came back.
Yeah.
So it was kind of the story's wicked, man. Because obviously your ankle's messed up. Come back, you get a trial, your ankle goes again, but you're just like, no, I'm soldiering on, and you're dealing with these guys acting like twats.
Yeah, basically, yeah. I mean, the ankle was never really, 100% because I never had the operation until after that last game against West Ham, and that got the UT manager even more angry because I was out for 6 months after that. Because the first surgeon cut my ankle open and done something inside, and then zipped me up and then said, oh, you definitely can't play. And I went for a second opinion, and the other surgeon, no, you just got some floating bone at the back, that's what's stopping your movement. Took the floating bone out, it's fine.
Second opinion.
Yeah,
that's crazy.
Just a piece of floating bone around the back of my ankle was stopping all my movement, and it's giving me so much pain.
Yeah.
It's about that big. Took it out, it was good.
Right.
Yeah.
That's crazy. So, did you enjoy your time at Millwall then?
No, not really.
Force the move? Did you go on a loan after that?
No. What happened was I was coming towards Mark McGee was the manager. I was coming towards my end of contract at Millwall, and my agent at the time said to them, "Right, what's happening with Leon?" He goes, "No, I want him. It was May." April, May, coming towards the end of the season, Millwall going for promotion. So he said, let me just get the boys promoted, because I wasn't in the first team or anything yet. I was still, like, you know, reserves, you know.
Yeah.
So he said, no, I want him. And let me just concentrate on getting the boys promotion first. And then at the end of the season, we're going to sort Leon's contract out. So I said, okay, cool, I'll wait. And he was fine with me, training everything. So come towards the end of the season now, my agent goes upstairs. He says, it's all right, let's sort Leon's contract out now. He goes, no, I'm not giving.
What?
What?
So why the time wasting?
Yeah, so that was a week the season's finished. I was nowhere to go.
Yeah.
I didn't have time to speak to anyone else.
Yeah.
I was told that I'm going to be signed by Millwall. And then he was just said, no, I'm not doing it.
Oh.
We've got promotion now. So I'm going to sign other people.
So
left me. And
what?
I, yeah.
So it was basically a thing where he wanted to keep you there in case they didn't get promoted.
In case they didn't get, he wasn't honest. Yeah.
Does that happen a lot in football?
Yeah, every time. Yeah. Every time.
So what did you do after that then?
Well, I was in a pickle. I was like, oh my god, like, I've just got a little car that I had to pay for, everything like that. Yeah. You know, so what happened after that? I went to Southend. Mm. Luckily, they'd seen me playing a reserve game. Mm. And they said, no, come down to us. So that's when I went to Southend.
Okay. How was your time there?
Oh, it was probably one of the best.
Really?
Yeah, there's so many guys I could relate to.
What league were they in at this time?
At the time, it was called Division 3.
Division 3.
Yeah, at the time. It was
old school. Division 3,
Yeah, exactly. No, do you know what it was? Because I could relate to so many guys there. Mm. There were so many guys from my area.
Sorry,
let's just pull the mic closer to you. Sorry. Is it the mic or...?
Just the mic. Just bring it up to your face, bro. Yeah, that'd be perfect. Like, bring it forward.
Oh, God. It's broken.
No, you just pull it.
Yeah, that's cool.
No,
don't raise it.
Yeah, it's Division 3. Do you know what it was with Southend? There were so many guys I could relate to from my area and stuff.
Yeah. Mm.
And that's why it was probably more enjoyable.
Yeah, of course.
You know? Yeah.
Southend. So what was your highlight, though?
What's the highlight of your career, man?
Probably hat-trick. At Southend.
You scored a hat-trick, yeah?
Yeah, I scored a hat-trick, yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Defender scoring a hat-trick.
Hat-trick of headers, yeah. Yeah. Hat-trick of headers, yeah.
But you're known for being a goal-scoring defender.
Yeah, I scored a few goals, yeah.
Said it in a casual way.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, there was a few goals.
So
you played for, like, what is it? 10 football teams, I think it is. And then national team as well.
Yeah, there's a few loans in there.
Yeah. So, like, of all of them, Southend was your favourite?
Probably Southend and first year at Stoke.
Okay.
Yeah.
That was enjoyable.
Was that the promotion when you got the promotion into the Prem?
That was serious times. It was crazy that year.
How was that going for
the promotion? It was because we weren't expected to get promotion that year. 2008-2009 season. We wasn't expected to get promotion. We was expected to finish mid-table. Mm. But we just kept churning out wins. See, at Leicester a couple of years ago, we couldn't lose. Yeah. That was like us. Yeah. We just kept winning. And then we did it. We came second. Mm. So we didn't win it, but we came second. Mm. And then bam, we was in the Premier League.
What sort of mentality did that breed for the players and the team, the unity?
Oh, it was brilliant. Everyone got with everyone that year. Mm. It was everyone worked for each other. Mm. There was no egos in that dressing room. Yeah. And that's one of the reasons why it was so successful. Mm. Yeah, but it was a crazy, crazy year. That.
And you also got promotion with Charlton, didn't you?
Yeah, 2011. Yeah.
How was that?
It wasn't as good. Yeah, it wasn't as good as getting into Premier League because I've got promotion with Hull as well.
Hull. I was going to speak about.
So. Yeah, it's amazing because you work hard every day. Mm. All these games up north, down south, all over the place. And to finally end of the season, get promotion is a massive achievement.
Yeah, of course.
What was the best team you played for? You know, because you've mentioned a few teams, Hull City, Stoke, Charlton Athletic. Mm. What team?
I'd say probably Stoke's team.
With what? With Ricardo Fuller?
Ricardo Fuller was...
Ooh, yeah, he's a bad boy, isn't
he? He was unbelievable.
How old was that guy?
20, I'd say maybe Jimmy. Yeah. At the time.
Listen, Ricardo Fuller was causing havoc.
Yeah, he was. He's unbelievable.
Any team, unbelievable. It didn't matter.
Real Jamaican man as well.
Yeah, he's top guy,
yeah. Ricardo, he scored a few goals, man. Mm. How many goals did you score at Stoke? About 10?
Nine the first year, yeah.
Cash.
For defender, that's
defender.
Right.
Yeah,
that's what I'm saying. Nine first year.
That's decent. But the thing is, obviously, like me and Kevin, Kevin said he saw something on 442.
Yeah. No, so obviously I was reading, and you know, you got these, what do you call it, like 442 Talk Sport and that, and they bring up the list.
Mm.
Yeah, and obviously they put you on the list of worst players.
Oh, yeah, yeah, I saw that.
50 worst players.
You were 26. How did you feel about that?
Yeah, do you know, I saw it and I just laughed. Mm. I laughed because at least you recognised me. But no, I know. But seriously though, it didn't bother me. I mean, who made that list?
Mm. Yeah.
What, fans? Yeah. Or, you know, yeah. Who made that list? Yeah. It doesn't mean anything to me.
That's the thing, because you scored 10 goals in 86 appearances for Hull City. Mm. You scored 9 goals, you know, for Stoke at your time at Stoke.
As a defender.
As a defender, and 7 at Crystal Palace, You scored some goals, man.
Statistics.
Yeah. Come on. Yeah.
Statistics. Not statistics. Statistics.
Come on. Like John Motson, I'm trying. Get the stats out.
Let's start throwing stats.
Stats, you know what I mean? Jonathan Pierce is in trouble. it's a bit harsh, you know? Like, how do you deal with that? The criticisms that you get from, you know, outside sources, you know? And, you know, how do you deal with it emotionally?
You have to be strong enough. Yeah. When I was younger, that probably would have affected me more. Mm. But when I got older and got more experience in the game, it's water off a duck's back. I think I know when that list came, it was after I left Burnley.
Yeah.
Because Burnley was my probably worst time in football. Mm. That was the worst horrendous time. Why?
Yeah.
It was after I left Stoke, after all that,
yeah.
I was told, after we got promotion, Stoke got 90 million, right? So what happened after that, they could buy anyone. Mm. So they were getting players in with more experience. So even though I knew I could do a job, the manager had to justify to the chairman, look, you've got this money now, go and get some experience. So he brought in, Ryan Shawcross was a new thing coming through from Man United. So he was already there. He had Robert Huth that they bought.
Yeah.
Ex-Chelsea, loads of Premiership experience.
Mm.
Abdoulaye Faye from Newcastle, loads of Premier experience. Mm. Who else was there? Danny Higginbottom as well. He was at Sunderland. So I was the one who came through the leagues.
Mm.
And those are the ones who already had that experience. Mm. So I was sitting at Stoke and I said to the manager, okay, if I'm not going to play, let me go.
Yeah.
He goes, well, I can't let you go until I bring one leaves and I bring another one in, then I'll let you go.
Mm.
So I had to sit there, fitness deteriorating. Wow. You got to remember, as I'm coming towards 30 now, so I need to be playing to keep fit. Because you can be out for 3 weeks and your fitness plummets more than you think, right? Okay. You play the odd reserve game, but it doesn't do much for you because you're not being pushed.
The intensity of first team football.
Yeah, exactly.
How does it feel when you're just sitting on the bench?
It's horrible. It's horrible. Yeah. It depends, because some people don't mind because they're getting paid.
Yeah.
But it still hurts you because you want to play.
Do you wait for someone to get injured? Does it get that harsh sometimes?
Do you hope that someone gets injured?
Not badly.
A couple weeks.
We always say, we're like, come on.
it takes one person to get injured for you to get in a team.
Yeah,
next year you taking us.
I mean, look at Matip and with replacing Joe Gomez.
Yeah.
I mean, Joe Gomez was
out for time though.
Oh, was he?
Yeah, Joe Gomez got that long injury.
I mean, he was doing well.
Yeah,
he solidified his place in the Liverpool squad, and then all of a sudden,
Matip
is coming.
But it shows though when Matip got a run of games, because he got injured, that's why Joe Gomez came in, isn't it? And when he got the run of games. Look at him. People are saying that he was actually better than Van Dijk towards the end of last season, which
really?
He was.
Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
It goes to show, if you need to run a game, anything can happen. So then what happened was my fitness was deteriorating.
Yeah.
Right? And I was getting unfit, and you get bored and depressed at home because you're not playing. You can't, when you're not playing, you can't, because I was from London, obviously, so I couldn't go back down to London after games much, because ones who didn't play were in on a Sunday.
To train.
So What you do, you start doing silly things. You get bored, and I was looking after other things like property and stuff. But at the time, when I was in my flat up there, the boredom was kicking. You start responding to a lot of girls. The girls start creeping in, and because I was so bored, you know. And then that's when I was able to go, and I went to Burnley, and that was just horrendous.
Let's take it back. You said obviously you were bored.
Yeah.
I'm guessing a bit of loneliness.
Yeah.
You start responding to the girls and you start, you know, going out and that. So, do you feel like there needs to be something in place to kind of help that, like the professionalism of the game? Because obviously a lot of footballers nowadays are getting, you know, a lot of slack for going out, partying, enjoying themselves. But obviously they don't take into account when they're on the bench or if they're not playing. You know, to keep themselves occupied, they got to do something.
Yeah, a lot of it's boredom. A lot of it is boredom. You play, you train, you go back to your flat, whatever. Because you don't usually buy a big place up there. You're not going to be there. Yeah, go back to your flat. What do you do?
Yeah, especially if you're single.
Exactly.
Yeah, they were saying that when he was away, like he was praying for someone to come visit him, or you know what I mean, to do something to occupy his time, sort of thing.
What do you do? I mean, because you got to remember, I was in the Premiership at the time, so I was go back to your flat. I was bored. I'd go on Facebook, and messages from 20 girls, like, my husband's away, come over. It's crazy. It's mad. Like, you just got these people just throwing themselves at you.
Yeah.
So you have to, you got to be a bit smart as well. You can't just do stupid things.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Of course.
You're never struggling for that kind of attention.
Yeah.
But that wasn't the attention that I was looking for. I wanted to play football.
Mm.
You know, I've always been like that. I've never chased women like that. I've always been like, focus on your purpose.
Yeah.
Women will always be there. They'll always come.
Yeah.
But do what you need to do first in life before you focus on all that.
We have to take into consideration your age at this point. How old were you at this point?
When I was leaving Stoke, I was coming to like 30.
So you're quite mature. You're experienced. You know the ins and outs of the game. I'm thinking of someone like Yado, who was at the tender age of 19, 18. You are going to, your mind's going to be different blown.
Yeah.
Different it's women, different you know, throwing themselves. I mean, at 19, your hormones are buzzing.
At 19, you sit down injured and birds are like, my husband's
is that way?
I'm saying nothing.
Hotel holiday in, innit?
it's that sort of thing.
What do you think needs to be in place for that then? Like, is there an educate? Like, do the academies need to educate the youth?
Yeah,
preparing them for those
because
it can lead to scandals like rape. You know, we hear
there's all sorts of things. I mean, there's loads of things need to be in place. There's guys that I know earn a lot of money. You know, I'm not gonna say any names obviously.
Of course,
this guy, I think he was on like 100 grand a week, right?
Jesus. How old?
And what was he? 25, right? And I was at his house one time, right? He had bailiffs knocking at his door. And I'm thinking, what are you doing? He didn't have to pay his gas bill.
Wow.
So they're not clued up. Yeah. They don't know. Things like that. Yeah. They're just in a bubble where they think everything's going to be sorted.
So they're not educated on life.
No.
And some footballers get their agents to do all of that, don't they?
Yeah. And then when they retire, they've had all these shysters around them from before. Put your money here, put your money here, because these people on the outside think you're dumb. So they use you.
Yeah,
and that's why you think, you look at it, you look at people like Gascoigne, and you think, how can you be broke? Paul Merson, how can you be broke after you've been on 30 grand a week?
Yeah.
But what it is that they're not schooled when they're younger.
And you're coming from a deprived...
Yeah.
Socioeconomic background.
Yeah.
So for you to be dealing with those finances,
money,
I mean, if I was 18, someone's like, you're making 100k a week, what would you do? You go nuts.
I was listening to Shaquille O'Neal, and obviously when he got signed to the NBA, they gave him a load of money, and he was like, he just started buying whatever.
Yeah.
And within an hour or something, it may have been less. He almost spent all of his money, and then he got a call from his accountant, like, yo, you need to calm down. Like, this is what you're doing. But that's the thing. His accountant called him and said, yo, slow down, man. Look after your money. Whereas his family were just happy to say, you're gonna get another paycheck next week anyway.
That's how it is. That's how it is. Even outside of football, I know I've gone off topic a bit, but if someone is, society doesn't, it's not built for you to be comfortable. It's not. Because if someone, I don't care what job you do, if you work a 9-to-5, right, nobody should be struggling to pay all their bills. You should be comfortable enough to live properly. You know, that's how I see it. But they give you just enough to pay your bills, just enough.
So that's basically money management needs to be everywhere.
Of course.
Just like what we were talking about in pretty much some of our episodes.
Yeah.
You know, money management in schools.
In schools.
You know, to start off with. Like, let's start teaching them from year 7.
But they don't do that.
Was there any point in your career where you like kind of you struggled like kind of financially in that sense?
Because when I was at Burnley as well, I was told to invest in some houses in Wales. But the guy that I was dealing with at the time said, "Oh no, leave it with me. You to concentrate on your football." But what? That's the worst thing I've done, because it turned out that there was nobody ever in those houses.
Wow.
They were a shell, you know. And I trusted him.
Yeah.
To think I'm investing for my future.
Yeah.
You know. So I'm still feeling that now. I'm still paying for these houses now.
Yeah.
That happens a lot, innit, in football.
Yeah.
You hear a lot of footballers go into debt because, you know, I trusted someone to do this for me. What footballer was it? There was a footballer that came out, I think, recently talking about that. I can't remember. But yeah, he got done by literally trusting someone to do the finances.
So Leon, what was, you speak about you being in like a flat by yourself, you were depressed because you weren't getting the games. Would you say that was your darkest time?
Yeah, it was because I was just going through a breakup as well.
Mm.
But it wasn't just a normal breakup. It was because my ex was suffering from alcoholism.
Okay.
But she had the kids, right? So it was hard. It was hard because what happened was, because she was struggling a bit, I told her to go to London to be around people because I was away every other weekend.
Mm, of course.
So she was in the house on her own with the kids. So I didn't, you know, I said, look, I'm not going to be at Stoke for that long anymore anyway. So you go to London.
Mm.
And I'll sort everything out financially and stuff, but you sort yourself out down there. So I sent her back, and that's when I was on my own. But we'd already kind of split then anyway.
Yeah.
But I knew the kids weren't safe. So I was going to court back and forth.
So there's a lot
whilst trying to uphold her career.
Yeah, uphold her career as well. And the judge didn't like her, you know? So I've got to go to a game tomorrow, not knowing, because I tried to call in the morning and there was no answer. There was no answer.
It's there.
Do you know what
and
I mean?
Then you have to try and play the game.
Try and play the game.
How did you deal with that?
Well, my brother was in London at the time.
Which brother? Carl.
Carl. Yeah, he was in London at the time. So I said, Carl, I need you to go over to my house. Like, go over to my house. And then I was in the dressing room. It was 1:30, and the manager was just calling the meeting. But my brother left a voice note on my phone.
Mm.
He was like, "Oh, Leo, I went over to your house. It was just full of smoke. Like, he couldn't even see his hand in front of his face." And because my ex had passed out on the sofa.
Jeez.
But, you know, because she left the cooker on and stuff. And he burst in and went and turned it off and stuff. And my kids are sleeping.
Wow.
Do you know what I mean? You know, and I've got Chelsea this afternoon for Burnley. Do you know what I mean? And every time the ball went out of play, that will just come back into my mind.
Yeah.
So I'm on the pitch. Like, I think we're getting beat 2-0 at the time. So the fans are on us. And I'm thinking, I need to get to London.
And the thing is, you are in London. You're in Chelsea.
No, I was in the game.
Oh, it was an away game. Okay, wow.
No, it was at home, but we had Burnley. I was at Burnley up north, and Chelsea came to us.
Jeez.
So, you know what? When players are, you know what? As fans, we need to be a bit more.
This is the thing. Like, these are the kind of things that we actually don't think about when we watch the football. They're just there to play a game.
Because if I'm watching, for example, Wijnaldum, he's been having a few poor games. Got to say it.
But little do we know, something could be going on at home.
You don't know what's happening there.
It's a cutthroat. It's brutal.
Did you speak to anyone at this point, Liam?
I don't think you're not allowed to.
In the club?
There's no place for that.
Mm.
Because I said to the manager, look, I've got to go to court this afternoon. Mm. Can I have the afternoon off? He goes, yeah. But he said to me, when you come back, I need you to leave your family stuff outside and come back in and train.
That's hard though.
Yeah. You know, he's not understand. What he's thinking of his job.
His job.
Yeah.
That's what he's thinking of.
But that's the thing. I feel like management, they forget about the human side.
Yeah, but that's the thing.
Because if it was him,
You
know what I'm saying?
You know what I mean? Yeah.
Because being a manager, you have to adopt many roles as a manager. You have to be like a coach, a father and all of that. You hear players speak highly of managers when it comes to things like that. For him to just say, leave your family stuff outside, just like that.
You can't. How can you? It's your kids.
Yeah,
it's your kids, you know? And when I was on the pitch, it was horrendous. It was horrendous for Burnley at that time anyway. Because I couldn't play to my ability. I was unfit because I just left Stoke.
Mm.
Burnley bought me for 1.2 million. Mm. And I just left Stoke. I was unfit because I hadn't played at Stoke. Do you remember? Mm. I mean, so now I had to go straight into Burnley's team and play again in the hardest league in the world.
Mm.
Unfit and family problems. It's never going to work.
Mm. Do you feel like there needs to be like a therapist, like a first point of contact for players when they're going through these things? Because, you know, we hear your Yaddo story and we've heard your story.
Mm. And the other guy that killed himself, the youth. That went on trial.
He killed himself. Do you think something needs to be in place for these players then?
There needs to be some sort of 24-hour hotline where you can call, but it's confidential because a lot of players won't do it. Because they feel like it will go back to the manager.
Mm.
The person you're talking to will go and tell the manager, Leon called me last night, and this is what's happening. Mm. And manager's thinking, I'm not going to put him in my team.
Yes.
You know?
And that's exactly.
And the thing is, especially like kind of being like, you know, high profile individuals like yourselves,
renowned to the media.
Yes, that's what I'm going to say. Mm. It's going to spread.
Because the NBA's even starting that. They've brought in a mental health specialist to be on retainer by the clubs and the teams themselves.
I should be standard.
Which is important.
I should be standard.
A lot of places have it. Why shouldn't football have it? They need it. Because a lot of mental... there's a lot of cases where, you know, footballers are hiding in the dark, for example. You know, they don't want to come out because of their sexuality or whatever. You know, and again, people in your situation as well. It would be nice to just, you know, let me speak to someone.
Yeah, deal with this, man. Absolutely.
It would help. It would help massively. I know it would help me back then.
How did you deal with it then? How? What was your coping mechanism?
Just had to get through it. I just had to get. I had no choice. I was on the brink of losing my mind. Right. That's how bad it was.
Did you ever? What was the darkest thoughts you had?
I'm not gonna try and cook up a story and say I would have close to taking my own life or anything like that, because I wasn't.
Yeah.
But I knew that I had to find a way, because of my kids. It was my kids, and I had to get through. I remember being on the pitch one time and the ball went out of play. So someone went down injured, and we were playing against Chelsea, whatever. And I was just standing on the pitch, and I think it was Drogba. Must have just been like that. What's wrong? Are you alright? Like, he asked me if I'm alright. It was that obvious that something was on my mind. Even an opponent is asking me if I'm alright.
Wow.
Do you know what I mean?
Like, yeah, you two are, you know, we're at war here.
We're at war.
Yeah.
You know, you're about to shoot your enemy.
That's nice of Drogba still. Man.
Yeah, but I don't know him personally, but everyone was saying that he was always a nice guy.
Nice guy, yeah.
But I don't know. As I said, I don't know him.
Yeah.
But, you know.
Did you not speak to your brother?
Family members?
Yeah, I did, but it's still difficult because I was away as well. I wasn't in London, and I had to be there. I had to be up north.
Because there's like no control. Like, you can't do anything.
Yeah. I wanted to handle it myself, but I couldn't. You know, but that was tough.
Wow. You think it would be like an easier to handle if you was like closer to home and closer to your
family? Yeah, definitely. Yeah. Definitely. Much, much easier, because I'm still 4 hours away on the motorway.
Yeah.
And playing in these tough games is always going to be tough.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking about the youth. I mean, you were experienced and mature enough to deal with your emotions. I'm just thinking about if I was like 16-year-old footballer, 17-year-old footballer, you're dealing with problems, you're getting all sorts of heckles from the crowd, the abuse, you know, what, you know, it's scary, man. It's like, what things are put in place, like.
And you know what, like, I want to touch on, like, racism, because especially getting a lot of racial abuse, like, what, is there not something that's being done? Like, is Kick It Out even doing that much?
Yeah.
Did you go through any sort of...
You hear the odd shouts, but, you know, when I went to Millwall, you hear the odd...
Yeah.
Imagine your own player, you know, you feel good to just say something stupid like that. Why?
Yeah, it's just a mindset, isn't it? It's stupid.
Like, for what? Oh, you didn't score the goal, you missed the penalty. Mm. You fucking African monkey.
Yeah.
Like, I don't understand, what's that going to prove? What's that going to do? Like,
yeah, do you know what I noticed? A lot of people in the crowd, a lot of them are angry. Because they wanted to play football themselves.
Yeah.
You know,
there's
people in the crowd. Yeah. And they work all week, and they come on the weekend, and it's a release. They can release some frustration on you.
Yeah.
That's what is a lot of these people.
Social media, I feel like social media has made it worse.
Yeah, it's, if
and,
I did, yeah.
And
if,
the FA need to do something about it.
They've got to start, you know, someone's got to do time or something, or something's got to be done.
Stadium ban, like, that's what they do in Italy, don't they? Like, where fans can't come to the stadium.
So, see, from your time at Millwall to now, have you noticed, like, an evolution of racism within football?
It was always there. I'm not going to try and pretend it was always there. But it comes out now more because of social media.
Yeah.
You know, people feel they can express what they want and get away with
it. But equally, I think social media has you know, made people more aware of the racism in football as well.
Yeah, a lot of people have their head in the sand. Sort of a lot of people say, oh, you know, stop using the race card. Every time a black person complains about something, people are using the race. It's not the race card, it's a fact.
Yeah.
There's a problem.
Yeah.
There is a problem.
Like, you can't feel okay. Was it Malcolm? Malcolm's gone to Zenit, St. Petersburg. They're telling the owner, get him out of here.
Yeah.
This guy's a good footballer. You're telling him, how does a player play football like that?
Yeah.
Put it this way, right? I know somebody, right? Obviously, I can't say his name.
Yeah, that's fine.
Right? I know somebody who said Zenit contacted them, right? And it's a big agency company. Said, oh, we need a left back. No black players, though.
Wow.
Yeah.
Are they saying that to protect...
Possibly. It could be either way. I don't know. But yeah, that's what they said.
Because black players have gone there. But what happens when they succeed? There's no racism, is there?
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? You make a mistake, you're already, you know, you're at the Wolves already, like, getting bananas thrown at you. Like, Emmanuel Frimpong, like, didn't he get into a fight? He strangled a player. Do you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Your own opponents saying racial stuff to you, like.
Did you, so you never, you know, you weren't on the back end of a racist abuse or anything?
No, I wouldn't say out. You hear the, all I could say when I was at Charlton, you hear you go past the touchline, you hear the odd shout when I was at Millwall. Mm. But other than that, I haven't personally experienced. There was one time at Burnley, a player, and I just come there.
Yeah.
Right, it was my first day. So you're trying to get along with everyone. And we had a five-a-side.
Yeah.
And if you have a bad game on a Friday, you have to go and goal, and you have to bend over, and everyone has to stand at the penny spot and blast the ball at the back side. You know what I mean? And this French lad who came over, a black guy, he had the bad, he had the worst training session, so he had to go and goal. And one of the, I just remember it was my first day, so I don't want to upset anyone. Right? And he goes, oh, I heard him say to someone, oh, I've never blasted a monkey's ass before.
Whoa.
And I'm like, I need to do something. But it's my first day. What do I do?
Yeah.
You know, I was in a hard position. Mm. Because if I go for him, everyone's going to back him, obviously, because I'm the new guy. Yeah, you know? And that's the only time.
They say it's so flippant. Like, it's nothing. Like, you know, it doesn't mean anything.
What do you think needs to happen with the racist abuse? From the fans to the players, what do you think needs to happen then? Because we hear a lot about the BAME and what they're trying to do with the whole kick it out and everything.
Someone needs to be made an example of. There needs to be huge bans or huge fines where it's not done again. But the problem is that when you've got these people 2 hours before the game going into pubs drinking, they've already lost their mind. So you're going to fine and ban, I don't know, 50 people every week or whatever it is. You know, it's a tough one, but something needs to be done badly. Someone needs to be made an example of.
I think honestly, with the Man United thing, with how rife it is and the stuff they're saying, like stadium ban, like no play, fans can't go to watch the game.
I mean, within the space of 2 weeks, like Pogba, Tammy Abraham, they've all been getting
like for what, missing a penalty. Come on, like there's bigger things in life. For you to be going to ruin a young boy's day, like again, this is where more so mental health therapists need to be in it, because as a player, if you've never dealt with that, like, and you're hearing someone calling you nigger this, you black this, like, bruv, you're gonna hate people, like you're gonna be an angry individual hearing that.
Yeah, exactly. Especially as a young lad, which you're saying, how do you deal with that as a young lad?
That's crazy.
So obviously, you've had a nice football career. What do you think about managers in the game, black managers in the game?
Because you're retired now, did you ever think of going into management after retirement, or like coaching role?
No, I want to get away.
Really?
Yeah, I had enough.
Why? Just football?
Just had enough. Like I say, I wasn't overly in love with it anymore. I've done it because I had talent. I enjoyed it. Don't get me wrong, of course I enjoyed it. Otherwise, I wouldn't have done it for 15 years. You know, but I enjoyed it, but I wasn't. I knew that when it was time to retire, I wouldn't be sitting in a dark room, like, you know, going crazy because I didn't have the banter of the boys again.
When did you come to the idea that I'm done with this, I'm hanging up my boots now?
It was, my knee was giving me trouble, like, in 2014, and I just knew that, I can't.
Oh, so was it a personal decision to retire?
Yeah. I mean, Southend wanted to sign me again for another year, but I knew that, listen, man, you put that ball down the channel, watching me run after it.
Guyana, how was it playing for the national team?
It was good. It was a bit of an eye-opener.
Yeah.
Because...
Is it worldly different, is it?
Is it worldly
different?
Yeah. I mean, it was... Going from the hotels we stayed in England for games to going to the hotels we stayed in Guyana, it was different. The training pitches.
Yeah.
And with my ankle, you got to be careful of those pitches.
Are they bumpy and all that?
Bumpy. It's like playing on a road. You know, but it was enjoyable because, you know, when you walk out and, you know, the national anthem, playing against Barbados, you know, St. Lucia, all those teams, it was nice. It was a different experience. Yeah. It was brilliant.
It must have been a real honour.
Yeah, it was. Especially my nan and my granddad were really proud. You know, we went out a few times with security. We wasn't allowed to go out on our own.
Really?
Stuff. Yeah. Wow. But it was really good. It was really good, especially to score against Trinidad.
What's that, in 2011?
Yeah,
that's
statistics.
Some stalker, isn't it? Look outside your window. You might catch that in the bush.
No, it was. I can't fault it.
Yeah.
I'm glad I did it.
When did you make that decision that I'm gonna play for Guyana? Did they approach you? How does it work?
Yeah, because my friend Faisal Khan, he is a big part of Guyana. Mm. And he, because we were so small, a lot of, there's a lot of players with Guyanese in them in England. Mm. You know, like Jay Boffroyd, you know, there's a lot of players, Callum Harriott. Mm. And, but they didn't really want to come at the time. Mm. So Faisal said, look, Leon and Carl, come play a couple of games, come play a couple of games. As soon as we did, then everyone started to really get on it. Mm. Get, you know, because they just come back from the Gold Cup, their mm. first ever appearance in the Gold Cup, which nobody thought they would ever get to.
Yeah.
And yeah, they're growing slowly. Okay. It's good.
Because your brother played for England, didn't he? Mm. And obviously, mm. can you make that shift though? Because I thought once you played for a national team.
No, he played for England under 21.
Okay.
So
okay.
it wasn't a full cap, so you can do that, yeah.
Okay, okay.
Now, you know, obviously, going to do a name drop moment. We, you know, I think you said you recently discovered that Ruben Loftus-Cheek is also your half-brother. Mm. Come on, name drop.
Mr. Sexy himself broke the internet.
Broke the internet.
Broke the internet. Girl, as soon as girl saw him in the England setup,
game over.
Who's he? I'm watching football now.
Like, you know what? He looks like Ghost from Power.
He does. Oh, yeah. He looks like Ghost from Power. Do you know what's actually funny about that? Yeah, because I'm scrolling on Twitter, you know, and I'm seeing girls are actively saying, oh yeah, he's so wicked, he's a really good footballer, isn't he? Yeah. I'm thinking, bloody just passed the ball.
No.
It's
crazy.
Yeah, okay. I mean, tell us about the story, because you said you only discovered that Loftus-Cheek was...
About 7 years ago.
Yeah,
I was... Because we get mail, when I was at Burnley, I think it was at Burnley, when I first got their first letter. Mm. We get fan mail and stuff. Mm. So I was sitting in the dressing room, opened the letter and said, I'm Juliet Cheek. Blah blah blah. Reading it. Oh, Ruben, and you got two brothers, three brothers, and one sister. Mm. Da. Can you come and see us when you come to London and stuff? So I thought, I wasn't sure if it was real or whatnot. Yeah. Mm. But I called the number anyway, and went down to see them in London, and just met up with them, and haven't looked back since.
Oh, nice. Have you grown a really strong relationship?
Yeah, we talk in that. We talk. He gets me tickets for games. Go around for dinner and stuff. Nice. Yeah, he's a real nice guy. Like, you know, we say with the attention from, you know, women and stuff. He's so clued up.
Really? Yeah, did you give him any advice? Like,
he didn't need it. Wow. See, he was so on ball. Like, wow. I'm not saying he doesn't see any. Of course, he sees girls, but he doesn't get sucked into
it. Very professional.
Yeah.
So that's like three professional football players in the family.
Yeah.
Strong genes.
Yeah, my dad.
You're the one.
My dad, he's crazy. He's, you know. Yeah. But
did your dad play football?
No. He's more into cricket.
Really? Mm. Mm. Oh wow. Mm. That's what I was saying as well. Actually, so like when you and your brother decided you wanted to play football, like how supportive were your family and your parents and stuff?
They were good. They were also worried about your education you know, Leon, you're going into it late.
Yeah.
What if it doesn't happen? Because I was doing graphic design at college.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and I was doing all right, but then Millwall, but I wanted to play football.
Yeah.
So that's why I took the chance.
Yeah.
So were they at every game, or they tried to make every
game? Tried to come to some games. A lot of games were away, so you couldn't really get to them. Mm. But they were supportive. They gave me everything I needed. Mm. But it's up to me to try and make it work. I was already told about the 1% of players who make it. A room out of 20... probably one guy's going to make it. Yes, and that's what these young lads need to understand now. Mm. Is that, you know, don't just go on Instagram looking at Cristiano Ronaldo's, you know, because you only hear about the success stories. You don't hear about the amount of players that get released. Mm. A lot of players, young lads, get released, and good players as well.
Because wasn't it Dell Jenkins, the guy that went to Bayern Munich, and now he's playing in, I think it's like the 7th league of football at 26.
Yeah.
Imagine going to one of the best European teams, their youth academy, and now...
I mean, when it comes to the youth, there are some shocking stats. I mean, you've got kids yourself. Mm. If your son was to ever come to you and say, I want to be a footballer, what would be the message you'd give him?
Ideally, I wouldn't want him to.
Really?
Oh, no?
Ideally, because I know that the chances of being the next Ruben Loftus-Cheek are very non-existent, aren't they? Mm-hmm. You know, it probably never happened. Mm. And I know that my son personally... Because I know what it's like, especially in the lower leagues, it's brutal. You know, you're 1 year away from not being able to pay your bills. Because you're not earning enough like those guys in the Premier League. Mm. You know, the pressure in the lower leagues is more pressure than the top. Because those guys are financially set after 1 year. Mm. They know they can feed their families.
Yeah.
You know, if you get released from, maybe not Championship now, but even Championship, some Championship lower than that, you get released after a year.
Yeah.
You got nothing because you know you there's not enough money. You're living month to month.
Yeah,
that's how it is.
Mm. That's interesting.
In the lower leagues, you find like a lot of people like kind of like have second jobs or jobs.
Some of them do. Mm. What I'd recommend is, and do you know what? There's a lot of African players as well. What they do is so smart. They go to college as well while they're playing. Mm. And one, I'm thinking Didi on Leicester.
Yeah.
He posted something. He was going to, he's in the Premier League as well, right? And he's going to college as well, right?
So there's no excuse.
There's no excuse. He said, oh, Jamie Vardy's going to get onto me because he knows I'm going to laugh at me and da 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 da. Doesn't matter. He's sitting because he knows that one injury, something, could, you know, ruin his career.
Yeah.
And he's planning for later on. And these clubs have to push that on people because it's such a short career. You get 10, 15 years out of it, you're lucky.
Really?
You're lucky. Yeah, it's so short. After 22, I didn't go on the pitch not injured. There was always something wrong. Whether it be my knee was sore, my ankle was sore, my neck, you've always got an injury.
Yeah.
Because your body's pounded every day. You're running on that hard ground. You're running. You know, I've got hardly no cartilage in my knees.
Wow.
Because I'm just pounding on the ground for 15 years, running. I've hardly got any cartilage left.
Wow.
You look got loads of money, son. You got loads of money.
I need a carnival.
You got to take it from this one here, mate. This one's done.
Yeah, need it. I'm sorry, mate.
So we're talking about black managers in the game, and of course you said you didn't want to be in the game. You were playing for Charlton when it was Chris Powell's manager. Mm. How was that to see a black man in a high position in the game?
It was really good. Really, he was a Charlton legend as well. Mm. So it's really good, and he was winning, doing really well. But I knew that if it turns, he wouldn't have as much time, and he wouldn't get as many chances. Because there's no doubt, if you look in the Premier League, how they recycle, not so much now, it's changing slowly. How they recycle the same managers. Mm. Hardew always gets a job.
Allardyce. Mark Hughes.
Mm. All it just recycles. And when you look at it, they haven't really done great. Mm. They've kept teams up, you know, but when you look at people like Paul Ince, I don't know if he'll get another job. Chris Powell just got sacked from Southend. I don't know if he'll get another job.
Mm.
They don't get as many chances. Darren Moore, he
did well as well.
Yeah, he started early, so he might get another job in time. But they don't get as many chances. It seems like a little union.
Mm.
And I'm not gonna. It's true.
Mm.
A lot of people say, "Oh, Leon, you're not." It's true. Mm. It looks like there's a bit of a union going on.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's like the people at the top don't really trust a lot of black guys.
But why though? Because like,
Chris Hughton's doing well.
Yeah, because like, you know, I read somewhere that, you know, 30% of, you know, the 92. Teams in the English Football League are made of black players.
Yeah.
You know? So that's a lot. And there are only 9% that are actually black managers.
Mm.
Which is a shocking stat.
It is shocking.
But it's not just here though. Because even if you look at like African international teams, most of the managers are white. Ghana's only had one black manager that I've seen.
Mm.
Like the Ghana team, when I was in Mauritius, the Ghana team came to play Mauritius, right? Mm. And I'm thinking, yeah, where's this manager, man? Is going to be a black man? Mm. Nah, man. I forgot his name, Ludovic or something. Mm. But yeah, I'm thinking, come on.
Yeah.
Like, even in African teams where the league is black, you've got a white manager.
Yeah, well, you look at Sol Campbell.
Mm.
Look what he's done. He was one of the best defenders in the world at one point.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And he's got so much experience and knowledge to give, but he can't get a job at a high level yet. Like,
so you've one black manager,
then? Huh?
Chris Hughton.
One black manager in the Premier League.
Yeah.
And he even got sacked from his last team.
Yeah,
didn't
he got sacked. But you look at Lampard and Gerrard, who just walked into jobs. Just walked into jobs because Lampard's a Chelsea legend, whatever.
Mm.
But he still walked into a job.
But do you think that's because of their career at the game in the game? But then again, you just mentioned Sol Campbell.
Campbell, you know.
Well, I did read somewhere that you know the EFL. English Football League are going to adopt the NFL's Rooney Rule.
Yeah, the Rooney Rule, yeah.
Which allows, you know...
They have to interview
BAME.
Well, they could just say, I've interviewed.
I've interviewed. Is this part of the protocol then, you think?
Yeah, I think it would be.
A tick box.
Yeah, tick box. Yeah,
that's it. Do you know what I mean? Oh, where you from, mate? No, your heritage.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, no, my parent, my grandparent. Okay, yep, done.
Yeah, tick.
it's not a guarantee that you even get there. Do you think when you're playing the game, do they push, like when you get to the latter stages, do they start pushing you to get into, you know, your coaching badges and all of that?
No, they don't really push you. They don't really get involved in what you're doing outside football. Okay. It's up to you. I mean, I know like hundreds of players that have taken their coaching badges that can't get a job.
Wow.
Because there's only so many jobs. Yeah. And a lot of managers won't bring you in unless they know you and can trust you because they're feared for their own position. Mm. So it's hard. It's sad in life. It's a lot of things in life. You see people who do these lot of degrees and get the degree can't get a job because they don't know a certain person.
Yeah.
You know, it's hard. Sometimes it's about who you know.
How do we encourage more managers or even black managers? Mm. Like for the existing managers right now, should it be like a rotation system? So like, oh, you can do like 15 years on and then you're done as a manager sort of thing. Because like football players have like a time span sort of thing.
Should the thing is, if that manager's done really well,
then
they're going to want to let them go.
And there's not, apart from Luis Boamorte, I could be wrong, I haven't seen many black number twos or
sitting next to you.
Even on the bench, you know.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, I think it's Torre, was it? He's at Leicester with Brendan Rodgers, isn't he?
Yeah,
there's not enough. And in the media, there's not enough.
Right, you are absolutely right. I was watching BT Sport yesterday, and it was me and Kevin, and we were watching, you know, the panel where they do the goal center and all that.
Yeah.
All of them.
They had a female. And what else was I watching? Was it, there was an interview on Sky Sports News. Les Ferdinand was talking about more black people being on those panels.
Mm.
And then when Sky Sports went back to the shot, you had two black people there. So they're talking, and you're thinking, what? So you knew you were going to put this up, so let's switch the man then quick,
It's crazy. There's no reason why it should be like that.
Yeah.
They're intelligent enough, you know. It's crazy. When you look at when Shearer first came out on Match of the Day, he was terrible. Mm. He was awful at punditry.
Yeah.
But they media coached him. Mm. Same with Phil Neville. Gary Neville started off, he's done really well.
Yeah.
But Phil Neville, he was really bad as well. But they media coach you behind the scenes. They give you the training, what you need. So that's why they're all confident in front of the camera now and they can talk really well because they're media coach. You know, you got to give people a chance.
Yeah, it's true.
Yeah.
It's true.
Just don't get it.
It's true. Yeah. Like, there is no difference between you and I, Gareth. Gareth's a Caucasian man.
Big up, cameraman.
But there's no difference. So why shouldn't I be afforded the same opportunities?
Mm.
Do you know what I mean?
Mm. Or provided with the same training.
Yeah. Exactly. Mm. Exactly. Yeah. Give me a chance and watch me flourish. Yeah. I guess, isn't it?
Exactly.
Leon, you've had obviously a glittering career. You know, a very fortunate one.
Mm.
You had a thing for scoring against your former clubs.
Statistics is back.
I mean? Come on. You know, Hull, Crystal Palace.
Yeah.
Against Hull. What happened there? You celebrated like a madman.
Yeah, I did.
I can't
actually
lie.
Do you know what? because a lot of the Hull fans got on me about that, but it wasn't to them. I wasn't celebrating because I scored against them as such, because I got bought by Palace from Hull.
Yeah.
So when I scored, it was like a relief to say, like, you know, I've...
I'm still that guy.
Kind of, but it was a little bit of pressure off me as well.
Yeah.
Because they bought me, at the time, I know it was only 1.2, but it was a bit of pressure off me as well. Because I've just gone to a new club, so I wanted to do well.
Yeah.
Then I stopped to realise, oh, I'm celebrating against Hull.
Yeah.
You know? And that's when the fans started thinking I was doing it against them, but I wasn't.
Did you get any abuse after?
Not really. I didn't. They booed me a few times when I touched the ball because they thought I was celebrating against them, but I wasn't. It was just I want to really do well here.
That's what
it was.
And I'll let Crystal Palace know that they made the right decision.
Yeah, basically. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
How is it when they boo you when you touch the ball? Because that must be mad. Imagine you boo.
Especially to know that these people once cheering for you. Do you know what I mean?
Sort of thing. If the opposition fans are booing you, you're fine.
Yeah.
It's fine. But when it's your own fans, that's when it's a problem.
Yeah.
How does it happen when it is your own fans? Has it ever happened to you when your own fans are booing you?
Yeah, Burnley.
And how did that feel? Whenever you touch one, did it make you nervous? Like, you don't want to make a mistake?
It can do. Because we was in the Premier League at the time, and we was getting battered every week. What? So, you're not enjoying it.
Mm.
You put Match of the Day on, and they single you out.
How does it feel watching it with your family? Here's my part.
Hansen killed me one time. Like, he just singled us out. You know, I tried to play offside, and he just bent the running, went and scored or something. Yeah. And like, you know your friends are watching it.
Yeah.
It's ping, ping. My phone's pinging off.
They're probably laughing.
I just turned it off, man. I just weren't going to answer any phone today.
Yeah.
You know, and I was sitting at home and I was angry as well because you want to do well.
Yeah.
You want to do well, and it's catch 22 is hard.
Mm. Yeah, but the thing is, obviously, the fans will be like, these guys, they get paid, you know, 50k a week.
It's always about their money.
You know what I'm saying? They can handle it. They can handle it. You know what I'm saying? We have every right to criticize them.
We're paying your wages.
typical thing.
We're paying your wages, man.
But the problem with that is that they're still human beings. And even though they're earning what they're earning and their family's secure and they're doing what they're doing, doesn't mean their mind is healthy.
That's where you
look at Aaron Lennon. He's been earned a lot of money, Everton and Burnley, wherever he's now. Still suffering mental health because his mind's not healthy. His body's healthy, but his mind isn't healthy. He's got problems, and that's what people don't see. It doesn't matter how much money you earn.
So obviously certain players get targeted, especially the media. How do you feel like? Have you ever been targeted by the media, apart from obviously, you know, when you said match of the day got onto you? Have you ever been targeted by the media, not saying on Sterling's side, but where they put a story out about you and it just wasn't fair?
Not because I wasn't a big enough name for them.
Okay.
Yeah, it's not much of a draw for them. But the way they treat Sterling is disgusting.
Do you think so?
Yeah. What has he done? Exactly. What has he really done? He's positive all the time. Right. Everything he does, you know, and they always try and find something to bring him down. Why is that? You know what I mean?
That's very true. Like when he got the gun tattoo, Piers Morgan, he's promoting gang violence.
He
even told you.
And what was worse about that is
they edited his story because he said he even put up the Snapchat thing saying, you know, my dad died by the gun. So. You know, and these man fully took that bit out.
Yeah.
And you're thinking, so you're manipulating people now.
It's
disgusting.
That's crazy. Business, man. You said, you commented on our YouTube thing and you said you wouldn't know the half of it. I've lived the game for 15 years as a pro. What did you mean by that? Were you speaking about?
Not you guys.
No.
I was talking about a lot of people outside. That a lot of people don't know.
What don't we know?
It's the ins and outs of some of the stories that I've told you, some of the things I personally went through. When you're out on that pitch, people think you're just some sort of Terminator. You don't feel anything.
Yeah.
Your life's bliss because you earn a certain amount. Of course, yes, you are lucky. You live a comfortable life more than other people, but you still have problems. And that's what people don't understand. You know?
And a lot of these problems as well is made worse by the money.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's a great point. That's a great point. You know? We don't see these things.
Because when you're earning that money, you're so young.
This is the thing.
You think you know what you're doing, you don't know what you're doing.
Yeah, especially if you've been educated with financial management. Yeah.
Did you ever take any players under your wing and say, you know, hey, look, you're getting a lot of money now, like, do this?
Or, yeah.
I don't know, any sort of advice, actually.
Because Yaddo said you were very good.
He said your praise is really high.
He was a really good guy, Yaddo. I feel so sorry for him. Because he could have gone to the top. He had everything. He was good on the ball, good mind, pace, everything. It's a shame.
I kind of, you know what, I'm not going to lie to you, because obviously, when he was at Charlton, I thought, when Chris Powell came in power, I thought, you know what? My brother's gonna get some game.
Black guy.
I'm waiting for him because he went on good loan spells. He was being rated. Comes back, nah, man. Like I personally didn't know how to take that. Like I don't feel like he got a chance.
He didn't really. Do you know what I felt? Because I was coming towards the end of my career when I got a chance. I thought they would have kept him for the future. Yeah, though. I didn't understand the reasons why they let him go. I would have definitely kept him. I don't know whether it was injuries. I don't know, but it was a strange one.
Because he didn't even get a reason from Powell, he said.
Did he not?
No, he said he didn't really get much. He was just like, nah, sorry, man.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm not sure. But
and it happens in football as well, where people just don't speak to you. They're just like, okay.
Yeah, they do, yeah.
Like you said. Who's that footballer? Basically, he went to the club and they sold him. He got a phone call saying, yeah, you've been sold.
Yeah.
That can happen, yeah?
Yeah, I've not really heard about that.
Who was it?
Because...
No, I need to look for this now. I'll look for it and put it in the comments, guys. Put it somewhere. But there was a footballer, like, basically, he'd been sold before he'd even known about it. Like, oh, you've gone off already. See you later.
Really?
Sort of thing. And yeah, you just got to pack your bags and go. Like, what can you do?
Wow.
That's crazy. I mean, you know, you've had, like I said, I keep saying, you've had a good career, man. Like, what about life after football? Because we see a lot of players going off the rails because they don't know how to deal with the change, the transition. You know, how have you kept yourself sane, let's say?
Even from 21, I was thinking, what can I do after?
Yeah.
You have to think about what you can do after.
Is that something you say to the young players, yeah?
Yeah, definitely. Don't care how good you are.
So you was actually thinking about that quite early, actually,
then? Yeah. I was always, because it's a short career and I didn't know when it was going to end.
Yeah.
Especially with this ankle, I didn't know what was going to happen.
And I think because you started late as well,
yeah,
I feel like, because you didn't get that academy stuff, you knew, okay, and your parents were saying to you, you know, are you sure, like?
So. Yeah, you've got to be, you've got to just try and plan. Get a trade, something you can, you know, earn money off. You have to. It's not going to last forever. You think it will when you're 21, but it won't.
So what does a day in the life of Leo look like now?
Yeah. Then life of me, God, sitting on planes all the time, like going to France. Yeah.
What a life.
No,
drinking good wine. Such a hard life. Like, sitting on planes.
Bonjour.
Before that, though, like after 2015, it wasn't easy though. Afterwards, because because of the property situation I had in a couple of houses in Wales. It was financially worked great because the situation they left me in.
Yeah.
You know, I had to find a lot of money to pay the bank back for houses that basically no one ever lived in. And they were just shells there. So I got conned on a lot of money. So there was a lot of stress back then. I had to, you know, find my way again. So that was probably my point in life when it was probably the hardest.
Yeah, because the money, you're not playing.
Yeah.
The money, you've basically been shafted by this
guy.
Yeah. And now you're having to.
You're trying to find work as well. People you worked with in the past, you go on LinkedIn, you try and make connections. You go on, they've read your message, zero reply.
Wow.
Yeah, the people you think that are going to be there for you when you finish.
We always think it's easy. No, you got all these connects.
You think that until it's time when you need them. Then they're not there. They're not there.
So how did you find your way into doing what you are doing now?
My agent, a company called Stella, he messaged me years ago and said, like, you know, there might be a position in France for you later on. Unfortunately, it came.
What was this position, sorry?
Like, just being an agent in France. And watching talent as well. So luckily, it's a bit of luck as well. And a bit of, he knows, because he's dealt with thousands of players. But he knows what sort of person I am. So he knows I'm not an idiot. He knows I can talk to people. I can sit in meetings and do things, you know, for the company and stuff, so he knows. So fortunately that came off for me as well, just giving me a chance to get things rolling again and back on my feet again and start pushing things in the right direction.
And is it something that you enjoy doing?
Yeah, I enjoy doing it. You know, I still see my family, travel, you know, you need that break from your family sometimes.
Yeah.
You do need that break, and yeah, but I can't complain.
Have you seen any rising stars, any players that you thought, when you first saw them, first game? There's loads.
Is there any names that you can mention that you've brought
upcoming
in?
Stars?
No, you know, I've got a couple of meetings going set up with the company, but I haven't brought any in yet.
But it's because
they've got agents already.
So you
have to try and be smart.
Smart,
you know, work it.
Yado spoke about agents and
picking the right one.
How do you go about, you know, let's say, pitching yourself as an agent to these footballers? How do you do it? Because I feel like agents need to just be more than agents. I feel like you're bringing in the money, but I feel like you need to be an educator as well for these young kids.
You do, it's important. A lot of companies do that now because the players are scared of you just rinsing them their money. So you have to try and offer other services for them. You know, trying to set them up, ISAs, put their money away. I know a lot of players that as soon as they get paid, they don't even see half of their wages. It goes straight into an account. And they can't touch it till after 30.
That's really good.
You know, so it helps a lot of players out.
Yeah.
Because they'll just go, they will, they will go to the shops and buy ridiculous expensive jeans and clubs and stuff.
You've got that money on your bank card.
And he's spending money on people that don't care about you.
So you see agents, when they approach talent, like, would this conversation happen like with their parents or guardians, or is it?
You can do, yeah. Okay. You can do. Sometimes the parents are harder than the players.
Really?
The parents, yeah, I would hope so, because like as a young guy, if I had an agent coming at me talking about ISIS, another one talking about what is glitz and glamour, as a young guy, I'm gonna, you know, Lamborghinis and.
Yeah. No, but also the parents want the best for their
child. That's why I think the majority and the.
And I think what helps you, I guess, is because you've been in the game. The dark side of that. You know what I mean? So you could. I think it's an easier pitch, to be honest. Like, if someone came to me that's been through it and said, you know, this is what you're gonna do, this is what we're gonna do for you, I'll be like, you've been through it, you've seen it.
Well, this is the thing. You say I've been through the dark side of it, right? I offered the PFA, they're not doing nowhere near enough. They're not doing nowhere near. The FA, the PFA, not doing nowhere near enough. I spoke to them about trying to help kids that coming up to try and avoid mental health creeping in, right? I pitch certain things to them. They have a little clique there, which they don't want to upset.
Wow.
Yeah, I'm telling you, they're not doing anywhere near what they should be doing.
They talk about grassroots, but they don't.
They think they are. There's a woman I spoke to at the time. I think she was about 45, 50. I speak to the lads. You don't know. You don't. Unless you've grown up in certain areas and you've seen certain things or you've played in that scenario, I've got something that you will never have.
Yeah.
But I couldn't say that to her at the time because I'm trying to pitch myself properly, do you know what I mean? Without sounding disrespectful to her.
Yeah.
What do you think about the women's game? Because obviously it's growing, especially after this World Cup here.
It's good. Why, you know, I'm glad they're trying to push it because there's a lot of talented women out there.
That's good, man. That's good. Man, it's been...
It's crazy, isn't
it? It's crazy. The world of football is...
You know, I've got one more question, actually, before we go to the table of truth. Who was the hardest player you've played against?
One player that just
kept getting won over.
Yeah. It was... Let me see. There's a few. There's a few strikers. Probably about three or four. One was Ricardo Fuller. His feet, his movement was just crazy.
Really?
Tevez. Couldn't get near him.
Wow.
He used to drop off in a little hole. Mm. And as soon as you go and follow him, he just spins in behind you. He's so smart up here. Strength wise, Adebayor, God. He's like this brick wall.
He looks so younger.
Drogba's strong. Strong, but Adebayor's got some different strength. I don't know.
African core.
You
know that one.
Dense.
You know that one. You try moving him.
You're not going anywhere, my friend.
There must have been a ball like it's 50 yards away, and the ball went over the top, and it was rainy that day, stuck in the mud, and it was a 50-50 between me and Adebayor, and we were sprinting to get to the ball, and he just went, bam, hand on my chest, and just stopped me.
Big man. This is my ball, man.
Gee, that was crazy for him.
Who did you look up to? Who's your idol?
Growing up, probably Gary Pallister. Man United centre back.
And is that why you're a Man United fan now?
No, not really. No, I used to like Cantona.
Okay.
That's big.
I look up to Gerrard, man.
Yeah.
Took me through some hard times. You know that Champions League final 2005.
Nah, that's big, man. That's big. Obviously, here is like, you know, we've captured some of your best moments, the highlights of your career. Which one's your favorite?
Probably this one and.
Yeah, hold it up. Come on, Leon. Yeah. Get it in there. Hold it up to that. That's one.
Tell us about that one.
This one is
promotion bus around the city. Yeah, after we got promotion. Drove around the city on the bus, parading and stuff. That was good. It was a heck of a night out afterwards as well.
I'll
leave it as that.
It must be surreal being on that bus, like you've got bare people following you.
It's just one of those times where you just got to enjoy it. Because there's lots of highs and lows in football. I know, don't take everything I say, like, there's been good times.
Yeah, there's been really, really good times.
But you have to always talk about the bad times.
Yeah. I mean, we see a lot of the good times.
Yeah, that's it. We see things at face value.
Just not see behind the scenes.
And what's the other one that you pointed at?
Which one is it? Where is it gone? This one is. This is my first goal for Palace.
Yeah. Hold it up. God, let's give it that. Hold it up to the camera. His first goal for Crystal Palace.
This one
against Southend United.
Yeah, that's right.
Again, your former club.
I'm worried. You
know.
This guy always scores against his former club, man. And you celebrated like a madman once again.
Pressure, innit? It's the pressure.
That's what we're using. It's the pressure.
It's the pressure. Yeah, the pressure. He forgot himself.
Yeah, that's what happens. You do.
How does it feel when you score a goal, man?
Yeah, there's no better feeling. Yeah. You're surrounded by that crowd. Yeah, there's no better feeling than
It must be nice. Like I see some of the, who was it? El Ghazi scored against Aston Villa's last win, and he just ran to the fans, and you can see his face to a fan, and you can see the passion. Do you know what I mean? I want to be that fan, yo.
Yo, man. Listen, Leon. Look, it's been
a pleasure,
an absolute pleasure having you with us on Threes of Social, man. This has been very insightful, very educational for us as well.
Especially for Carl, being someone that doesn't really like football.
Yeah, I'm a big football fan, Lord.
Yeah.
Fair enough. So it was interesting to see his reaction.
But I think that's why I think I kind of appreciate that bit more, because I'm finding about things that I don't know, like football sort of thing, do you know what I mean?
No, I've had a good time.
That's cool. Oh man, cheers, man.
It's a pleasure to hear that.
Yeah.
And to hear that you wanted to come on, man.
I see what you guys are doing. It's really good. Really good.
Cheers, man.
Yeah, more people need to do stuff like that.
Thank you very much.
You hear that, yeah?
Listen, you've just tuned in and listened to Leon Court on Threes of Social. Make sure you subscribe, drop a comment, share it.
And hit us with any questions that you have.
Any questions. We'll put Leon's, what's it? Your Instagram on there if you want to hit up Leon if you've got any questions, especially these youngsters.
Mm-hmm.
We'll hit you.
And if you're in France, looking for an agent as well.
Leon, any last messages before we go? Anything that you want people to know? I don't know.
To know. Just focus on your purpose. Just do what you need to do. Just focus on your goals. Everything else will come. Just remain positive.
That's it.
Big up. Leon Court, Threes of Social, Forza Party. Come on.
Till next time.
Cheers, guys.